things, if that's okay.
What about home meal being 1%, ranging 1% to 2% as opposed to home?
Right, so dairy is a really individual topic. So I mentioned before that dairy is one of those categories that can be inflammatory. So that's the initial consideration, is whether or not that's something that can, maybe might not be good for you at all. So it can be, very mucus forming and that kind of thing, which is not great for folks like you. But if the question is with regards to whole milk versus like a lesser percentage fat, I would always recommend whole milk. I think that just having that, it tastes better, and if you can get an organic whole milk, I think it's better, and you just have less of it. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
It's a really hard question, right? Like, that's why it's hard.
And I was saying, less percentage fat or because of the fat.
Well, that was true for a long time, and a lot of people who are, watching calories, where I think that's where the having skim milk and 1% is better, and I think a lot of nutritionists or dietitians might disagree with me, so I'll just say that up front. But we know that having skim milk without the fat, not consuming the fat with the sugars that are in the skim milk, you're just hitting your system with sugar. So that's kind of why, that's one of the reasons why I just like having the fat.
What about the flavored milks, almond milk?
Oh, yes. So these are a lot of the dairy alternatives, right? Oh, we could talk for a long time about that. There are a lot of options. A lot of them do have added sugars. A lot of them have some preservatives in them. I use them because I like to stay away. I don't really eat dairy for myself because my system doesn't process dairy very well. So I try to get an unsweetened almond or coconut milk, and I look for products that don't have, there's a specific ingredient called carrageenan. I don't know if anyone familiar with that. It's an emulsifier, and it's like, controversial. So I just try to avoid that one. And it's not in all of the brands, so I just try to avoid it. Did that answer your question?
Okay. You may have already addressed high fructose corn syrup.
Yeah, I talked about, the four. Yeah, so that's an ingredient that's in a lot of processed foods. And I discussed the sugars in the beginning, and I really like just don't like, I just like to avoid that.
Well, I bought a jar of prunes, every once in a while,
and
I'll eat
prunes.
Yeah. So, after I became aware of high fructose corn syrup, I read the ingredients on everything to almost an obsession.
That's a good thing to be obsessed with.
High fructose corn syrup is in that. A liquid form, and so I drained it and put water in instead. Then I called the company on their 800 number. Very interesting. They are fully aware of how bad that is for people. They took it out at one point. And it's banned in Europe, it's banned all over the world, except the United States.
Yeah.
And they've gotten so much butt from their customers for taking it out.
Because of the flavor? Because of the flavor. Can you find the dried prunes?
Oh yeah.
Do you not like them as much?
Oh, they're fine. It's one example of
Oh yeah, it's in so many packages. That's why I was saying, always read the ingredients, know what you're getting, and try to just get the whole food. So even the other dried fruits and things are made with a lot of sugar. And a dried fruit already has a lot of concentrated natural sugar. So you want to avoid the ones that also have more sugar in them.
Dried apricots?
Yeah, no, I feel like dried apricots are one that don't usually have, but they might have sulfur for preservation, but maybe not extra sugar. But craisins have extra sugar. Yeah. Makes me really upset. Sorry. I know. It's like life is already really boring. So a lot of dried cherries have sugar in them. So you have to like go out of your way. I don't know if any of you guys like to go to Trader Joe's, but they have one that's unsweetened and unsulfured. And I like that. Right. No, I like them. They're so good. Yeah. But my taste might not be like yours.
It's one step at a time.
Right. It is definitely one step at a time. I have to say, I grew up on not the best diet. In fact, I felt really at home next to this microphone because I used to work at a place called Arby's, and we had a microphone, and we'd be like, can I get a beef and cheddar? So that's what I grew up eating, and so I understand it's definitely one step at a time. And nobody's perfect. That's why I like this good, better, best thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great question. One more time about you. Okay. How come it's so much more expensive buying it on hand
versus buying it? Oh, yeah. Okay, that's like another one.
We tried it, and grocery thing just went up.
So. Yeah, it can get really expensive. The thing that I have to say about spending a little extra on organic or higher quality foods is that, yes, it can be more expensive, but for example, like with meat and eggs and things, you can probably get away with eating a little bit less of it. Also, you're possibly saving money by not eating out as much if you're buying those foods and making them at home. And then finally, if you consider the repercussions of not eating well when at all possible, those repercussions can get quite expensive. So I think if you prioritize it and also educate yourself on what you don't need to buy organic, that's why I wanted to mention that Dirty Dozen and the Clean 15, because the you really don't need to buy everything organic all the time. And you also can get things, frozen things sometimes can be a lot cheaper. When it's in season and you get it fresh, it can be cheaper. So those kinds of choices can help make it a little less expensive. But it's a really, really valid point. And I think that our food supply, again, that's a whole other topic, is filled with lots of choices that kind of work against us and our health. So we have to be aware and kind of fight against that. Did that answer your question?
Yes, yeah, perfect. What kind of condiments would you recommend? I like condiments in the real big area. Yeah, I grilled some chicken and now I'm smothered in barbecue sauce.
Right, that's a really great question. So going back to, do you remember that salty sticks slide? I gave some alternatives with like fresh herbs and spices and citrus, I think, is a great alternative. Apple cider vinegar is great for giving things flavor. Maybe not, I mean, there's apple cider vinegar diets where you like drink a bunch. That's not what I'm talking about. And then you can get different healthy cookbooks. In this particular book, I love, she has a whole section on condiments and she calls them dollops of yum, which I think is so sweet. And they all look really, really, really good. You know, you don't have to like follow all the recipes, but you can get some ideas of how to make your own things. I think that's kind of the trick, is making your own condiments and keeping it simple and making your food taste good to you. Because like, you know, if it tastes good to me, it doesn't matter. Yeah. That was a great question.
Another question, maybe I just confused, but when you were going over the whole grain section, 100%, and you said, you know, the good was 50, the better was 100, and the other was whole grain.
Right.
If something says 100% whole grain, it's not technically whole grain.
Well, so that particular stamp that says 100% whole grain, if you see that on the product, it is 100% whole grain. But there was another one that didn't specify, and that was the one that I think causes the confusion. Oh, you were asking why is it better to eat an actual whole grain versus a product that has the label on it? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, that's a good question. Usually, if there's a product that has to have that stamp on it, it means that it's made with some flour and maybe a lot of other ingredients. And so that's why I think like eating the whole grain where you cook it yourself, you know exactly what's in it. That's a good point.
So if it's whole grain, I would cook it, that's better. If I'm in the store, I want to see 100% whole grain.
Yes, okay. Yes. Thank you.
And I don't want this energy to stop. April will be here after this meeting, so please keep that energy going. She's a wealth of knowledge and graciously has shared, and she's going to send the links. I'll make sure Dawn sends that out to everyone, and those that do not have email, like I said, she will, we'll have the recipes here next month. But April, I want to thank you for graciously. Here's a token of our appreciation. Thanks again. Let's give April a round of applause. One of the tiny habits that I've learned so far this year are portions. So just a little tidbit, if I go out to eat, I only eat half my meal. And I take the other half home. Because what was just an eye-opener for me, this is a portion of pasta. So when you go to an Italian restaurant and you get a plate of spaghetti, I'm very confident that that plate of spaghetti doesn't look like this. But it's about probably 5 or 6 of these. And so it was, and it truly made a huge difference. It's just really quick water. You know what? I do not like drinking water. But I do like drinking water that's infused with cucumber or pineapple or strawberries. You know, so just food for thought. That's just a sharing.
Thank you. Thank you.